Blackstone Publishing presents Reclaiming My Decade Lost in Scientology, a memoir by Sands Hall. This book is read by Sands Hall. For Tom, who lived so much of it with me. 'Tis the temper of the hot and superstitious part of mankind, in matters of religion, ever to be fond of mysteries, and for that reason to like best what they understand least. A Historical Account of Two Notable Corruptions of Scripture by Isaac Newton. Later, he believed he had learned the truth of Paul's words, where he said that God's word was like a mirror in which a man might see not only the man he was, but the man he might be. And he came to understand that the proper business of life was trying to do something about the difference. Harlan, In Unassigned Territory, by Kem Nunn. Foreword, Knowledge Report. For a decade, I pretended that a decade of my life hadn't happened. Those lost years included the 7 I was involved with the Church of Scientology and the 3 it took to be certain I wouldn't again return. Eventually, I began to peer and prod and then write about those years, and just as I'd completed a shaggy draft of this memoir, I found out that Jamie, the man who'd introduced me to the church, had died. A memorial was planned for him in Los Angeles, a city I'd fled decades before and since visited just once, and then only because a book tour took me there. Because I'd been examining what had come of meeting and then marrying Jamie, it seemed imperative to attend his memorial, even though it meant putting myself back in the maw of what I'd found first scary, then intriguing and even engrossing, and then, during the awful time of leaving, terrifying. I would also see people who'd once been incredibly dear to me, but with whom, since leaving the church, I'd lost contact. One of them, Paloma, who'd been not only a close friend, but also one of my auditors, Scientology's form of counselor, even offered her guest room. Paloma's open-heartedness and willingness to walk outside Scientology's boundaries moved and surprised me. Generally, those in the church do not associate with those who have defected from it. But Paloma welcomed me, and as we always had, we talked deeply, including about what we were currently writing. She pressed, and finally I offered up that I'd finished a draft of a memoir. About Scientology? She looked shocked. I told her it was also about my family, which was, in a way, its own kind of cult, I said, laughing. Clearly troubled, she asked me what I meant. After a bit more discussion, I suggested we not talk further about it. When you get your next chunk of auditing, I said, you'll have to answer all those security questions. I don't want to make trouble for you in any way. Paloma shook her head. I won't let the church dictate who are and are not my friends. I found this admirable, and though surprising, even possible. Paloma has been married to a non-Scientologist for 3 decades. Perhaps she and the church, she and her own psyche, had figured things out. And for a few months after that remarkable and unexpectedly heartwarming time in Los Angeles, she and I stayed in touch. In one startling phone call, she even implied that she might have accomplished all she needed to with and in the church. However, almost immediately after that confidence, if that's what it was, the phone calls and emails stopped. As Scientologists put it, we fell out of calm. I was not surprised. I knew she was regretting our candid discussions. A few months later, a mutual friend told me Paloma was very ill. This, too, I did not find surprising. Because Scientology, like Christian Science and other spiritual paths, believes that physical troubles are linked to emotional and psychological ones, I was fairly sure that Paloma was tracing her illness back to our talks. If she had entertained any doubts, and certainly by communicating such feelings to an ex-Scientologist, she was guilty of transgressions against the church. By now, she'd be seeing someone known as the ethics officer, maybe getting auditing, in any case, spending lots of money handling that she'd talked to an apostate. She would not be in touch again. So I was startled when, a few months later, I received a business-sized envelope with her name and address in the upper left-hand corner. Standing in the morning sun next to my mailbox, which is at the end of my driveway in the rural area where I live, I opened it. Inside were three typed pages. Centered at the top of the first page were the words, "Knowledge Report." For even a seasoned member of the Church of Scientology, the phrase "knowledge report" can buckle the knees. To be the subject of one can curdle the blood. Knowledge reports are one of the increasingly totalitarian tactics L. Ron Hubbard employed as Scientology became bigger and more successful and more controversial. In a 1982 policy letter, Keeping Scientology Working, he writes that for an organization to run effectively, quote, "the individual members themselves enforce the actions and mores of the group," end quote. This can lead to rampant paranoia, as it's possible to imagine that every step you take in your job.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.